Father, tonight we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful to come into your house. God, we want to hear from your heart. And so tonight, Lord, I pray that as we open up the word, you would open it up to us. Open us up to receive it, Lord. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Lord, we acknowledge tonight that it's not about a man or a woman, the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. It's about us coming together and hearing from you. So welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all of our brothers and sisters, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. God, they're our brothers and sisters, Lord, and we don't think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. We see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So bless all the churches out there that are preaching Jesus, God, tonight, this weekend, whatever it is, God, Lord, we ask that your spirit be amongst them as you be amongst us. God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world, Lord. We ask that you cover them, protect them, bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, guide and direct them, Lord. Deliver them, Lord, from prisons and bondages. God, we're so grateful. Many of us prayed for Pastor Saeed to be returned. God, he's home. And so we're grateful, God, that you hear our prayers, Lord, that you see and that you answer, God. And so, Lord, we love you and we give you praise tonight. In the mighty name of Jesus, we're all in agreement and we say, amen. Amen. All right, you guys can have a seat. Thank you guys for jamming with me tonight. Do you guys just appreciate our worship team? They're awesome. If you have your Bibles, go with me to Hebrews chapter number, not 11. Let's go to 12, all right? Figure we're in 11. 12 is a couple years from now on our weekend studies at the rate we're going. So I figured it'd be okay to use a verse out of Hebrews. I want to talk to you about a subject called God's work in the wilderness. You know, I've been going through a season of my own life where, in the month of January, we're starting something. Usually we start the year out with a fast. And, some of you guys have joined us in that fast, and some of you guys have, maybe did a 21-day fast, like a Daniel fast or something like that. Some of you guys may be doing coffee or entertainment or something just to seek the Lord and just to find out what it is that God wants to do, or to pray about this year, to pray for the church, that sort of thing. Thank you guys for joining us in that. I personally have been fasting and finished a 21-day fast, but I still have one more thing that I'm doing right now. I'm doing coffee throughout the month of January, and that is like, the sacrificial lamb upon the altar right now for my own personal life, because I love coffee. Ever since I was a kid, I remember walking down the cereal aisle to get cereal, and on the other side is always the coffee. And I would walk down the aisle going, because I love the smell of coffee. Now, when I would taste it as a child, ooh, bitter. No, I don't like that, But now that I've grown older and, it was kind of like Starbucks, they got you started with the sweet, and then eventually you worked your way into the coffee. It was kind of that gateway drug sort of a thing with the Starbucks, and then eventually you were in deep. That's kind of how I was with coffee. And so this month I've been fasting. Now, what's interesting for me is that, it seems like every time I've done this over the years, which we've done this at the church for quite a number of years, some sort of a fast in January, and every time I've done it, it seems like all during the fast, God says nothing. I don't know, some people are like, oh, Pastor, I've got pages of notes about what God's been speaking to me during this fast. It's been amazing. I might continue it, this and that. What are you learning, Pastor? And I have to stand there and be like, I'm still pressing in, and try and make it spiritual, because really God has not said a word to me. And I feel like, my goodness, I'm the pastor. I should be the spiritual one here talking about what God's downloaded and all the vision and all this kind of stuff. And God has been silent. And it's like, oh my goodness, what am I doing, God? Am I afflicting my soul for no reason here? And it seems like on the last day of the fast, I don't know what it is about January 31st or whatever the last day of January is, for some of you guys are judging me because I don't know right now. That's okay. It's all good. But, you got that little rhyme in the grade school. I missed that day, apparently. But, the last day of January, I don't know what it is about that day, but it seems like that last moment that God just comes with this crushing revelation of what it was that he was having me fast for and what it is he's doing and this and that on that last day. And it's sort of like a wilderness time for me. I'm kind of wandering. But like J.R.R. Tolkien said in his books, The Lord of the Rings, there was a poem where he said, "Not all those who wander are lost." Isn't that interesting? Because when you think about it, even the children of Israel who wandered in the wilderness were led by a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. God was with them every step of the way, and they didn't move unless that pillar moved. So they were wandering in the wilderness, but really they were being led of the Lord through that wilderness time. And as I looked throughout the Bible, I did a little study and just was thinking about some different things throughout the Bible about people who went into wilderness experiences. And for all of us tonight, whether you feel like you're in a wilderness experience or whether not, sometimes we look at those experiences with eyes of fear. We kind of think, well, God, I don't really want to go to the wilderness because I know that for the children of Israel, a lot of bad stuff went down in the wilderness, right? There are people falling down, tens of thousands of people, fires burning up the edges of the camp, then snakes are breaking out, you know, the earth is opened up and swallowing people whole. You know, God, I don't want to go to the wilderness. Anybody can say amen, you know? I felt that way. God, please don't lead me into the wilderness. And yet when I look throughout the Bible, it seems like any time something significant happens, whether it be the miraculous, think about it, the children of Israel, right? Here is a supernatural, miraculous move of God. The plagues of Egypt, the firstborn, the parting of the Red Sea, the Egyptian army is wiped out. And immediately after this great, miraculous victory, what happens? God leads them into the wilderness to be with himself. Jesus, here's a great image. Jesus, here he is anointed. Here he is, right? He's baptized by John, right? John says, no, Jesus, you should be baptizing me. Jesus says, no, let's do this to fulfill all righteousness. John baptizes Jesus. As Jesus is coming up out of the water, the book of Mark says the heavens are rent, literally ripped open, never to be the same, and the Spirit of God descends on Jesus like a dove. Oh my goodness, miraculous, right? Supernatural, booming voice from heaven. This is my son with whom I am well pleased. And right after that miracle takes place, what happens? Jesus is led into the wilderness. And in our lives, we need to recognize and realize that God may be doing something miraculous. God may be doing something amazing. God may be doing something wonderful. And now we have reached that point, and now God's going to take us to a new level. God's going to do something in our lives. God has a work that he does in the wilderness for our benefit. And therefore, get ready because God may be leading us. And if you're not currently in a wilderness time in your life, you may be going there as soon as the miracles have taken place. Are you listening tonight? So tonight I want to take a look at a couple of things. What God does in the wilderness. Four things God does in the wilderness. Now, even the bad, even the difficult times in the wilderness are for our benefit. So when we look at these things, some of these things you may be saying, well, I don't want to be led into the wilderness for that, Pastor. I don't want God to do that. But listen, if God doesn't do that, then it will be worse than if he did it. You understand? And we'll see that in the first one. Four things that God does in the wilderness. First one is this, is that God gets something out of us. God gets something out of us. In other words, there are things in our life, things in our character. Things in our thinking that do not belong. Just like a tumor in the body that the surgeon says, I need to take you into the operating room and I need to get that thing out of you, otherwise it will harm you, right? We all understand that. So God is taking us to the operating room of the wilderness to get something out of us that if it was left in us would be harmful to us. We see this in the children of Israel, right? Here they are, they come out of Egypt, come out with the miraculous. God leads them into the wilderness. Now think about the journey through the wilderness, right? They were supposed to go from Egypt up into the promised land. Now God had a plan for them, and God had to get some things organized in their lives before he could do that. He wanted to set up the sacrificial system. He showed Moses the tabernacle system, right? They set up the worship. They set up the sacrificial system because God needed them to understand who Messiah was. So there was some time that took place. Moses was up on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights, and we know that that was over a month, right? So this little journey that could have taken anywhere from 11 to 13 days. Now you think about moving millions of people and children and cattle and all that other stuff, all the goods of Egypt that they plundered would take some time. So let's give them some time. Let's say it would have taken them a month to go from Egypt up into the promised land, plus a month to stay and receive the sacrificial system, and maybe we'll just throw another month in there to organize, okay? So 3 months journey, let's just, for our thinking, a 3 month journey took them 40 years. Why? Because there was something that was in them that if it stayed in them, would have harmed them in their future. You know the story, they come up through the land. They get to the edge of the promised land. They send spies into the promised land. As they send the spies into the promised land, they come back and they talk about how great the land is. They talk about the fruit. They show them the fruit. Everybody's excited about that. But then they start talking about, but there's some people living in there that are giants. We saw the descendants of Anak there, right? We saw their fortified cities. They have large walls. And we were like grasshoppers in their sight. So there's fear starting to come out, and it turns the heart of the children of Israel away from following the leading of the Lord. Now, you know the story, Joshua and Caleb, only two men that stood up out of the 12 spies, the only two that stood up and said, we can do this, were Joshua and Caleb. Caleb especially was like the spokesman, right? He stood up, he said, let's go up at once. We are well able to do this. But they said, no, we can't do it, and they murmured, and they complained, and they cried before the Lord. And God says, I want you to turn back into the wilderness. Now, why would God do that? Why would God send them back into the wilderness he just brought them out of? Because there was something in them that if it remained in them, if they were to go into the promised land in the present condition, they would die by the hands of their enemies. How do I know that? Because they tried going up after God told them to turn around and they fell at the hands of the people of the land. You can read that in your Bible. So they would have been wiped out if they would have went in without faith. So God knew that he needed a heart that believed him. He knew that he needed a heart that obeyed him. He knew that he needed a heart that just trusted God said it. God says we can do it, then we can do it. Let's go. A heart like Caleb, a heart like Joshua, who eventually were giant slayers, right? Here comes Caleb later on. He says, give me this mountain. That's my mountain. And he goes up at, my goodness, 80-year-old man going up there and takes a mountain for himself. Why? Because Caleb was so cool? No, because Caleb believed God at his word. And so what they had in them was like cancer was going to hurt them. And so God says, I want you to go back into the wilderness until the bodies of those rebels fall in the wilderness. What was God doing? God was patiently waiting while they were going through that wilderness time. Now, in their experience, it took them 40 years. And he says, I want you to go throughout this wilderness and go around, and wherever I lead you, you'll follow. And while you're in the wilderness, I am getting the rebellion out of you. It's very interesting to read the book of Deuteronomy. It says until all the men of war died. Isn't that interesting? Their sons, who were going to be the ones to take the land, were actually shepherds. Never fought, never picked up weapons, didn't train. God was speaking something. God was saying, I'm going to get the rebellion out of you because it's not about your training for war. It's about your faith in Almighty God and his word. And so I'm going to get rebellion out of you in this wilderness time so that when the timing is right to take the promised land, you will believe me at my word and go and do what I've called you to do. Could it be that some of us in this place are in a wilderness time because God is getting something out of us? Maybe God sees something in your character that he's saying, that cannot stay because you're going to push people away from the gospel rather than bring them to. Could it be that there's something in us that will hurt us like vanity? That we love the mirror too much, or we love the accolades of other people too much, you know, or that we love the present world so much, that God takes us into a wilderness time. See, sometimes people, they get saved, and they have these great experiences, and right, you know, you're on fire for the Lord, you're hearing God's voice, and everything is wonderful, and then all of a sudden, you start to go into this wilderness time. God, I don't hear your voice like I used to. God, I don't experience your presence like I used to be, God, that when I would raise my hands and I would sing to you, God, I would just be crying and the people around me would be crying and it was like the fire of God was falling out of heaven, but now I'm not experiencing that. What's wrong with the praise and worship team? Pastor used to preach and it was like he was spitting fire, right? The lightning was coming down out of heaven just zapping my soul. I mean, it was just electric. It was wonderful, but now I don't know what's wrong with the pastors. Maybe they're just not on their game anymore. And we plateau in life and we wonder what God's doing and we wonder where God is. Could it be that God is showing us something? Could it be that God has spoken something to us that he's waiting for us to act on? Could it be that he's getting his finger on something in our character and he wants to get that out of us because if it remains in us, it will hurt us? Hebrews chapter 12. Did you turn there? All right. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 11, it talks about how we're God's children. And if we're God's children, then God deals with us like a father would. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 11, look at what it says. Now, no chastening. Okay, that word chastening means a discipline. No chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Sometimes when God makes an incision, he cuts deep and he doesn't put you under. Mm-hmm. Some of you guys know what I'm talking about, right? Sometimes you've been in the presence of God and rather than saying amen, you're saying, oh me, right? I know I've had those experiences. God, that hurt. Why would you do that to me? See, no discipline, no chastening seems pleasant or joyful at the time for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, look at this next word, afterward, right? No one wants to go under. No one wants to have the operation. No one wants God to remove it. But afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. Look at this. To those who have been trained by it. In other words, if we don't learn the lesson in the wilderness, if we're not trained by it, then we're going to have to take another trip around the mountain. You know what I mean when I say another trip around the mountain? Children of Israel wandering in the wilderness, right? They probably said, we've seen that rock before. We've seen that shrub before. We've seen that tree before. We've seen that mountain before. We've seen this side of the mountain. We've seen the sunrise over here. We've seen the sunset over here. I've seen that lizard before. So he's following us. I know he is. See, they took another, and they took another, and they took another, and they took another, and they took another trip around the mountain. Why? Because it wasn't until every last one of their bodies fell in the wilderness that were of fighting age at that time that God could finally bring them into the promised land. It's no different for us. There may be a fighting man called rebellion. There may be a fighting man called vanity. There may be a fighting man called division. There may be a fighting man called impurity. There might be something inside of us that's going to kill us when we go up against the devil and against the world. And God is saying, I need you to take another trip around the mountain so that you can be trained by it. God might be wanting to get something out of us in our wilderness times. Second thing, I know that's a kind of an oh me, so I don't mind you guys not clapping and shouting for that one. But four things God does in the wilderness. Number one, God gets something out of us. Second one is this, is God gets something to us. This is a fun one, right? We all want provision. But have you ever thought that sometimes God does something unusual? That God will take you out of the comfort of the city. God will take you away from the hustle and bustle, from the familiarity of family, right? And God will draw you out into a wilderness place because God wants to get something to you. I had an experience one time. I was the young adults pastor here. I did that for 7 years, and I just loved it, loved the young adults, and passionately in love with them, and was looking at doing things better, and I had seen online that there was a conference in New York about reaching urban youth. And I said, well, you know, we got some urban youth here at this church. And so I grabbed Pastor Richard, our youth pastor, and we went out to this conference in New York. Now, while we were there, I remember I was just pressing in. I was waiting for God to drop it on me, right? Here I am at this conference, you know. This is supposed to be the mountaintop experience, right? You're supposed to have the praise and worship. And I mean, they had some of the biggest names in like Christian praise and worship that you could have out there, right? They had one guy had a 100-member youth choir. I mean, it was just like the best, okay? Now, I'm praising the Lord, and I'm waiting to hear about our church and about how to reach urban youth, right? Now, I heard messages on grace. I heard messages on, the favor of God. I heard messages about how to pastor and how to lead yourself and to-dos and not-to-dos and all that kind of stuff, leadership stuff. And I'm waiting. And you know what? They never really talked specifically about how to reach urban youth. So I said, okay, God, I guess I'm just looking at what they're doing and how they're doing it. They're in New York. I mean, it doesn't get much. I mean, that's city, you know, that's inner city. I mean, that's, if there's ever a city, New York is the city. So I guess I'll watch what they're doing and I'll apply that to our city youth, you know. Now, Pastor Richard came back and he went to one workshop where, you know, he got some stuff that we said, okay, this is cool. Well, that's one out of like the 19 we went to, you know, but okay, I guess one's better than none, you know. And so I was talking to him and asking him about like, okay, so, you know, what are we doing with the youth and the young adults? And really we thought just some tweaks, you know, just you know, give some little here, little there, do this and that and some adjustments. But really we were doing okay. And so I was kind of scratching my head saying, God, what am I doing here in New York if not this, right? And God starts talking to me about the next season of my life. And I stopped God and I said, we were praising, just worshiping God. God started speaking to me about it. I said, whoa, wait a second, God, wait a second. You mean to tell me you brought me all the way across the nation to be alone with you here and now so you could talk to me about this? And he says, oh, yeah. I said, why? He said, because I got your attention now, don't I? See, sometimes God will take us out of the hustle and the bustle of the city. He'll take us away from the familiarity. He will get us uncomfortable in a wilderness time. Why? So that he can get something to us, so he can drop it on us because he has our attention. Hopefully this is helping someone tonight. You got your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings. A guy by the name of Elijah shows up in 1 Kings. He's an unusual character, as a matter of fact. Elijah. And the first time we see him is in 1 Kings chapter 17. Turn there with me. 1 Kings chapter number 17. This is how we are introduced to Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse number 1. It says, and Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead. That's how we're introduced to him, okay? We don't know who he is. We don't know that he's a prophet. All we know is that he shows up and he says something. Said to Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. That's how we're introduced to this great prophet. One verse. Here you go. Elijah showed up. He said this. Okay? Now remember what I said. Oftentimes it's after a miraculous event taking place that God leads us into the wilderness. Okay? So here he is. He says something that obviously the king is not going to like. The whole nation is going into a famine. That's really what that just meant. And this one guy, all he has to do is say the word for rain to come, and rain will come. You can conclude that, right? Because he says, accept at my word, right? So if the king knows, Elijah, if I can turn his arm behind his back long enough, I will make him say uncle, or say rain in this case, right? And so he says, that would be the natural thinking of King Ahab. Now, King Ahab was a wicked king. And so that would have been the thought process. Oh, it's not going to rain? Well, I will put you under affliction. I will put you under pain until we get the rain. So the very next verse, look at verse number 2, it says, then the word of the Lord came to him saying, get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. Verse number 3, so he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. Verse 6, the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Now notice, God told him, I want you to get away from here. Get away from the king, get away from the city. This would have been the city center, right? So he says, get away from here and turn eastward and go towards the Jordan. Now, if you've ever been to Israel or you know anything about the Jordan River, really there wasn't like a lot of settlements or anything around it. You know, the river would flood, and so it was kind of a wilderness place. That's why John the Baptist, you'll find, when he came in Matthew chapter 3, it says he came preaching in the wilderness, and then he was baptizing people in the Jordan, okay? So this would have been a deserted place. It would have been a wilderness place. Notice that Elijah goes, and he goes to this little brook that's feeding the Jordan River, and there he can drink from the brook, and he can eat from the ravens that God commanded to feed him. Unusual. And yet God had Elijah's attention. God had Elijah's interest. God knew that in that place, that all Elijah had to do was follow the will and the way of the Lord, and God would get what he needed to him. It's no different for us. No different for us. God may be leading you. You may have wondered, God, how come the money's not there? God, how come I don't have everything that I think I need? God, I've been looking for a word. I've been looking for wisdom. I've been looking for direction. But God, I'm coming up short. And God is saying, I want you to go into the wilderness because it's in that place, it's in that spot that I will supply your needs. Now, oftentimes we think that God's going to do that through money, right? Oh, well, if I need food, then God will give me money, and then I can go buy food. But have you ever thought that God doesn't need money or food to sustain you? If you fast forward in Elijah's life, right, there came another great victory. Here he is on top of Mount Carmel, right? Here he is with Ahab once again. Here he is with the prophets of Baal. And they have this showdown. They've got a sacrifice. They've got wood. They've got an altar. And he says, whoever's God answers by fire, that's the one true God. Now, you know how the story goes. Here's the prophets of Baal cutting themselves and crying out and dancing and doing everything that they can, and no fire. Elijah even starts to kind of poke at him a little bit. Maybe he's asleep, right? Maybe he's on the toilet. Go get him. You know, maybe you need to shout louder and wake him up, right? And so they start shouting louder and cutting themselves more and all this stuff, and nothing happens. And finally, Elijah steps forward and says, okay, enough of this foolishness. Calls upon God, and God answers by fire, consumes the sacrifice. He had poured water on the sacrifice. The fire came down out of heaven. It consumed the sacrifice, the wood, and it licked up all the water that was in the trough around the sacrifice. And he says, seize those prophets of Baal. They're false because this is the one true God. So they seize them. They defeat them. In one day, Baal worship is wiped out at that point. And then he goes and he prays, and rain comes down out of heaven, and he outruns a chariot. I mean, it's miraculous. Miraculous. It's a great victory. God was on his side. God answered by fire. And yet one little threat from Ahab's wife Jezebel sends him running where? Back into the wilderness. And when he had run until he ran out of strength, he falls asleep under a broom tree. And there under the broom tree, an angel comes and wakes him up and says, you need to eat. And there he finds on coals a little cake and jars of water, and he eats and he drinks. Now listen, that's supernatural. Because he didn't see that when he ran up. There were no angels saying, hey, take a rest here, and when you wake up, I've got lunch waiting for you. It didn't happen. No, the angel showed up, and the provision showed up supernaturally. Second time it happens, he eats again. He says, the journey's too great for you. You need to eat and drink again. And so God was leading Elijah, and finally Elijah ends up in a cave, and there in a cave, in a wilderness place, deserted by everyone else, the word of the Lord comes and gives Elijah direction. Think about it. Supernaturally, God spoke and gave Elijah what he needed. Same thing with Moses. Remember, Moses went up onto the mountain to meet with God. 40 days and 40 nights, he ate no food, nor he drank no water. Can I tell you something? Any of us tried that, we'd be dead. Unless we were in the presence of God. Because the very presence of God is what sustained Moses during those 40 days and 40 nights. Oftentimes we look with natural eyes and we say, God, I don't see what it is you're doing. God, I'm in this wilderness place. God, I need provision. And God is saying, don't look to the natural. Look to the supernatural. Look to the leading of the Lord. Listen for my word. I will supply. I will provide in my way and in my time. God is good. So what does God do? What are the four things God does? And honestly, you could look and you could probably find some more in your Bible. But these are just four things that God spoke to me for us tonight. So number one, God gets something out of us. Number two, God gets something to us. I like this one. Number three, God proves something in us. God proves something in us. Remember, Abraham went up on the mountain, right? God had asked him to sacrifice his son, Isaac. It was a 3 days journey from where they were at. On that journey, Isaac's carrying the wood, and we know that God provided a ram in the thicket, right? God provided a sacrifice for himself. Now, what did God say afterwards, right? The angel of the Lord stopped Abraham, said, now I know. Now, let me ask you a question. Did the all-knowing God not know what was in Abraham's heart? Was God really wondering about whether or not Abraham would follow through? Or what was God really doing? God was proving something. God was showing Abraham. God was showing the world, literally, because now we read the story today. And it's not just a history lesson. This is something that's an example for our lives. God was showing us what Abraham was made of. In other words, Abraham's radical obedience was proven when he went into that wilderness place. Remember I talked about Jesus, right? That here's Jesus. Here he is. He comes up out of the Jordan River. The Spirit of God is descending on him like a dove. And the voice of God booms out of the heavens. This is my son with whom I am well pleased. I love him, right? And so now here Jesus is. He's anointed with the Spirit of God supernaturally and miraculously. Matthew chapter 4, verse number 1. Look up on the overheads with me. Look at it. It says, then Jesus was led up by who? I'm sorry. That was like the front row. How about the rest of you guys? Jesus was led up by the who?
Spirit.
The Spirit. God was leading him. Where? Into the wilderness. To do what? To be tempted by the devil. Now, if I knew God was leading me to be tempted, not by one of the little minions, but by Satan himself, I might have to stop, like I did in New York, and say, God, hey, hold on a second. Are you sure about this? And yet I would have to trust that if God was leading me there, God knew what I was made of and that I could handle the temptation. Is that right? Just like Jesus going to Peter saying, Satan has asked to sift you like wheat, but I prayed for you. That when you are come through, that you will minister to your brethren. Notice he didn't take him out of the problem. He didn't take him away from the trial. Satan was still going to come after him. And we see that. You see Peter. You see the restoration of Peter. You see how Peter encouraged his brothers when he was restored. And so we know that God has a plan for the wilderness times. Sometimes God wants to get something out of us. Sometimes God wants to get something to us. And sometimes God wants to prove something in us. This is those things that we didn't know we had. You know, that strength that all of a sudden it just comes out of you in a time. Sometimes you didn't realize you memorized scripture until you start quoting it. Anybody ever had that happen before? Right? You say, when did I learn that scripture? It just kind of bubbled up out of your spirit, right? It's that river of living water that God planted inside of you that when you got out there, maybe you heard the verse in church or maybe you were reading in your study times, your devotionals, and then you got out in the workplace and something happened, problem hit, and you said, hey, if God be for us, who can be against us? Oh. I don't remember memorizing that verse. Maybe you got into a situation with a relative that doesn't believe in the Lord and you started to witness, and as you're telling them about Jesus, just scripture is flowing out of you and it's just applicable. And every time they ask a question, you have the answer and you're going, when did I ever study for this? See, what is God doing? God leads us into those wilderness places. Sometimes when we look at them, we don't know what it's all about. You know, if you look at the desert, you kind of wonder, how could anything live here? I mean, what's going on here? And yet God may be bringing you into that season of life so that he can show you what you're made of. Can I tell you something, church? You are stronger than you know. Let me say it again. You are stronger than you know. Because if the Spirit of God lives on the inside of you, what can come against you? Who can bring an accusation against the Lord's elect? What can separate us from the love of God? Death? The devil? Persecution? Trials? Problems? Temptations? I like you guys. You guys are responding over here. What can separate it? I'm going to preach to them if you guys won't respond. Come on now. Nothing. Nothing. We're stronger than we know. God could be trying to prove something, showing us what we're made of. We're stronger than we know, church. I'm reminded of a story of a U.S. military man in World War I, while he was out on the field, one of his friends had a young lady that wanted to encourage him, and she wanted to send one of the U.S. military servicemen a book. And so they selected this man, and he had never met this girl before, but she sent him this book with a letter saying that this book would encourage him while he was out there in the field. And so he wrote her back a note of thanks, and as they started writing back and forth, they developed a relationship, being pen pals. In fact, it was some of this young lady's words that brought this guy through some of the toughest trials, and she was a godly woman, and oftentimes she would put scriptures in there, and those same scriptures, when he was in the heat of battle, would carry him through. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. I will fear no evil, right? And it was in those moments of battle, he'd be quoting those verses, I will fear no evil, and he could go on and he could make it. And so he knew that he was coming back home, and he wrote her a letter and told her, I want to meet with you. If you'll meet me, I'm going to be in the airport terminal at this time, and I'm going to bring the book that you sent to me, and I'll be holding that. That's how you'll know it's me. And I'd like you on the lapel of your coat to wear a red rose, and that way I know it's you. And so the moment came for them to come together, and so here he is. He's all excited. He's dressed up in his military uniform, and he's coming in, and he's got the book in his hands, and he comes walking into the terminal. And right as he walks into the terminal for this meeting, a blonde, beautiful young girl comes walking up, and she says, hey, soldier, going my way, and she walked out the door. Now, she didn't have any flower on her lapel, and for a moment, he stopped and was kind of getting ready to go her way, you know what I mean, right? What's that all about? But he looked past this young, beautiful woman, and he saw an older woman, gray hair, heavy set, sort of plain, with a big, bright smile on her face and a red rose on her lapel. And so he looked away from the young woman, and he walked up to the older woman, and he held out the book in his hand with a smile, and he says, ma'am, it's a pleasure to meet you after all this time. I'm so thankful for all that you've done. Can I take you to dinner? And the woman smiled even brighter, and she said, son, I don't know what this is all about, but that young woman that just passed by, the blonde, told me to put this rose on my lapel and said that if you came and talked to me, that she would be waiting for you in the restaurant across the street. See, for all of us, we need to recognize and realize that God has good things in store for us. If we will hold on and let God's character come out of us, let the strength of God come out of us, let the things that God has placed inside of you come out of you. See, if you've got God on the inside, then when you're jostled, when the world squeezes you, only God can come out. Isn't that neat? See, I love what, I believe it was Amy Carmichael, she was a missionary in India. She was bedridden, and she wrote these amazing, brilliant books at the end of her life. If ever someone had a reason to complain, it would have been this lady. And yet she said, if I am full of sweet water, if I'm a cup filled with sweet water, doesn't matter how hard you jostle the cup, only sweet water can come out. Not one drop of bitterness can proceed from that. It's no different with us. It's no different with us. God may be trying to prove something in us. Last thing, four things that God does in our wilderness. Last thing for tonight is that God does something through us. I like this one. Because oftentimes we think about what God is doing in me or to me or removing from me, right? It's all about me. But what if your wilderness time isn't about you? You ever think about that? Sometimes we bewail and we moan and we say, God, why does this have to happen to me? And God says, not about you this time. Oh, there's some things that I see inside of you that I might want to remove from you later on, but right now, I'm going to do something through you. Think about the disciples. Here they are with Jesus, right? They're traveling, ministering all over the place. They're so weary that they're begging Jesus, can we just go take a break? I mean, like, can we rest? You've been working on the Sabbath. You've been doing all sorts of stuff. You've been ministering to people. You've been praying. We've been just going, Jesus, can we please just go get away from the people? And can we rest? So Jesus calls his disciples out into a wilderness place, right? He calls them to a deserted place. Now, you may know the story. Here they are in the deserted place. They're supposed to be there for some R&R, some rest and relaxation. And what happens? The people hear Jesus out there in the wilderness. And they follow Jesus to the wilderness. And so Jesus moved with compassion. And because Jesus just loves people, right, what does he do? He teaches them. He ministers to them. He's going all day long. Now, the disciples, they did what probably we would have done. They would have said, oh, jeez, we were supposed to be here. And then he's teaching. I mean, the guy, he doesn't stop. Where does he get that from? He hadn't eaten a thing all day. I'm hungry. Are you hungry? I'm hungry. Hey, Jesus, send the people away. They're probably hungry. Right? It's for the people, Jesus. Not, I mean, we would like something too. But you know, send them away because they're probably hungry. Now, you know, Jesus does something, right? He does a miracle. He takes 5 loaves and he takes 2 fish and he feeds the multitude. A miracle takes place there in the wilderness. Now, I was looking at this in the different books of the Bible, and out of all 4 Gospels, this is the one miracle that's recorded really in all 4 Gospels at length. You can find this, they have what's called the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They're very close, and you can find most of the stuff. But then John comes along, and John has some different stuff and doesn't have some stuff. And sometimes people wonder, well, is that contradiction? What's that all about? Really, it's just 4 different views, 4 different camera angles, if you will, of the same events. But this one event was so important to God that he kept it in all 4 of the Gospels. And I believe that God is speaking something to us. He's showing us something. And in the book of John, chapter number 6, I'm going to read this to you in the Message. So if you want to turn there and read it in your translation, whatever you have, the New King James, King James, or NIV, whatever it is, you can read it in your translation. Because it's kind of fun when you read it, because you almost catch Jesus in like a little smile. Like there's an inside joke going on between Jesus and the Father, and the disciples don't know about it yet. So you can read it in your translation, but I'm going to read it in the Message. And it says this in the Message. It says, when Jesus looked out and saw that a large crowd had arrived, he said to Philip, where can we buy bread to feed these people? Now, think about Jesus for a second, okay? Get whatever picture you want, Jim Caviezel or any of those images that Pastor Luke had up on Sunday night. If you guys were here, you remember all the different images of Jesus. Get one of those images. Get Jesus in your mind, whatever you think Jesus was looking like. Okay, average Jewish man, that's what the Bible tells us. Okay, but think about him just with a little smirk on his face. Hey, Philip. Yo, Phil. Come here, man. Hey. Where do you think we can get bread for all these people? Now, look at the next verse. Verse number 6. He said this to stretch Philip's faith. Some of your translations said he said this to test him. Right? Look at the next sentence. He already knew what he was going to do. In other words, God was going to get something to the people. God already knew what he was going to do. He already knew their little boy with his lunch coming up to the meeting. Jesus already had in mind, because he was led of the Father. He says, I only do those things which I see the Father doing. So Jesus in prayer would have already had the plan for what he was going to do that day. He was being led of the Spirit of God. The Spirit would have revealed it to him. And so therefore, Jesus already knew. So Jesus had an inside joke that was going on between him, the Holy Spirit, and the Father. And now he's bringing the disciples in. Hey, Phil, where can we get bread for all these people? Right? If you read the other translations, they start reasoning. Well, you know what? A year's wages couldn't buy enough food for all these people. You know, if we sent them in the towns, they wouldn't be able to sustain them, right? So they're scratching their heads. They're trying to work it out. And then finally someone comes along and says, hey, we got this little boy. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fish. You know? And in the natural, it doesn't look anything. But look at Jesus already knew what he was going to do. He just needed to stretch the disciples' faith. For all of us, if we're going into a wilderness time, it may not be about us. It might be about us stretching our faith. God might be wanting to do something through us. God might want to take you out into a wilderness place to meet up with a woman at a well who's down and out, who is hurting. God might have you going out to the wilderness to meet up with a man who's filled with demons. God might be sending you out to the wilderness, led of an angel, so that you could come upon a chariot where there was a eunuch reading the word of God and saying, how can I understand? See, God knows the times and the seasons. God knows where people are at. And people might be wandering in the wilderness, lost, and all they need is you to wander into that same wilderness, led by the Spirit of God, so that God can do something through you. It's not about us all the time. God may want to do something through you. 4 things that we learned about what God does in the wilderness. Number 1, he may want to get something out of us. Number 2, he might want to get something to us. Number 3, he might want to prove something in us, or number four, he might want to do something through us. Now, I'm not done yet, so thank you for those wonderful, encouraging claps. But if you're going through a wilderness time, what do you do? How do you know? How do you determine? God, what are you doing here? Now, you can pray and ask the Holy Spirit that question, and the Holy Spirit might tell you. Or it could be like me on my fast, where God just says nothing, right? And he lets you learn the lesson the hard way so that you remember it. But in any event, if you are following God and you know that God is leading you into a wilderness time, here's what you do. Keep following God. Keep trusting the Lord and allow him to bring that message to you, whatever it is, one of those four things, or it could be something else that God's doing in you. Let God do the work in you. In other words, if God's leading you to take something out of you, okay, God, do the surgery on my heart. Whatever you need to take out, let's get it out. Because it would be better than taking another trip around the mountain. If God wants to get something to you, then don't try and go make it happen. No, God, where are you leading me? God, I want to follow your direction. And it may be unusual directions. Wilderness times are often unusual. And yet, God knows the place of provision. You've heard where God guides, he provides. If God's going to take you in the wilderness, he better be the one providing for you. Right? There's no streams in the desert unless God does a new thing. Hello? So just keep following the leading of the Lord. Keep your eyes on Jesus and let him do the work. Deuteronomy chapter 8, neat section of scripture. Deuteronomy, Moses is preaching to the children of Israel. And in fact, the whole book of Deuteronomy, if you read it, it's really kind of like three different sermons that Moses preaches. And in this first sermon in Deuteronomy chapter number 8, he's talking to the children of Israel, and he says these words, and he's really speaking on behalf of God. And he says this in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse number 2, "And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way." How many of you want to go all the way with God? Okay, praise God, I came to the right place tonight. He says that God led you all the way these 40 years, where? In the wilderness. To humble you, to test you, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandment or not. Right there is most of what we learned tonight, isn't it? Now, drop down to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse number 10, okay? He talks about the provision. He talks about the manna. He talks about the different things that they did. He talks about how their feet didn't swell, their clothes didn't wear out. God did all this stuff in the wilderness. Verse number 10, it says, "When you have eaten and are full, then you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land which he has given you." Now, I love this quote that I'm about to say to you. James Smith is an author, wrote some great books, and he said this. He said, "The hungry soul cries to God, 'Lord, bless me.' But the satisfied soul says to God, 'Lord, I bless thee.'" Let me say that again. The hungry soul says to God, "Lord, bless me." The satisfied soul says to God, "Lord, I bless thee." In other words, at the beginning of that wilderness time, often it's a dry and a thirsty land. And we're crying out, "God, Lord, bless me. God, give me the provision. God, take this thing out of me that you need to. God, show me what it is that you want to show me. Prove in me that character. God, do it. God, show up. God, if you don't do a miracle, it's not going to happen. God, reach the lost. God, do something in me and through me." We're crying out, "Lord, bless me." But afterwards, when you've come out of that season, when you've come out of that wilderness place, then your soul is satisfied. God's gotten the provision to you. God's gotten that thing that he didn't want in you out of you. God has proven to you who you are, how strong you are, what he's done in your life. God's taking you to new levels. God has used you mightily. It's at that time that the satisfied soul cries out to God and said, "Lord, I bless you." Can you say amen to that? The wilderness times, we look for God's work, and then we praise him for it. Can you guys give the Lord a praise tonight one more time? I want to talk to you guys before you leave this place. I want to make sure that your heart's right with God. And that if you left this place tonight, and through no fault of your own, it was your last night here on the earth, I want to make sure that you're right with God. There was a wilderness time of my life. I want to just share a bit of my testimony with you. I was 15 years old, was raised in a Christian home. Parents told me we were Christians growing up. Had a Bible, went to
church all my life. I remember growing up in church. Went to youth group. I was leading worship in the youth group, playing guitar and singing songs to Jesus. And yet, at age 15, my brother had left for a missions trip, went all over the world preaching the gospel. And my brother, who was a very melancholy type personality, came back and I could see in his life something was different. I could see in his life something had changed. And he shared with me about Jesus, and he shared with me things that I thought I already knew. And he told me about the love of God and how they shared Jesus with other people all over the world as they traveled with their missions team. And I remember going into sort of a wilderness time, if you will. I was confused. I was worried. I was concerned. I had a weight that just sat kind of on my chest. And I didn't know what to do with it. That night I went to bed with my clothes on. It's important because my brother had given me a little gospel tract that I just simply slipped into my pocket. And in the middle of the night, I woke up. And now looking back on it later, I realized that the Spirit of God was just there in that room, hovering over me, leading me to something in that wilderness moment. And I remember I got up and I didn't know what to do. And I got out of bed and I decided, well, you know what? I'm in my clothes. I might as well change for bed. And the first thing that I always did before I went to bed was I would empty my pockets. And there when I reached into my pocket, I found that little gospel tract that talked about things that I thought I knew about Jesus. And I realized as I looked through the pages of that gospel tract that I had gone to church my whole life. I had been involved in ministry. I knew about Jesus, but I was still lacking in an area of my life. And there that night I prayed, and I gave my heart and life to the Lord, and I've never been the same. Some of you in this place tonight, you were raised in church, born in America. America is the so-called Christian nation. Some of you guys have done a lot of good deeds. You used to be bad, but you cleaned up your act, and now you're good. And part of that is you've come to church. Some of you guys have known about Jesus. You know who God is. And yet, if you were to search your heart right now, you're feeling that emptiness and that weight on yourself right now, and you can identify that you're still lacking in some area. The problem is that we have all these different ideas and all these different ways that we think that we're going to be a Christian or that we think that we're going to go to heaven. We think if we can be good enough, if we can know enough, if we can do enough, we'll make it. And yet, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say, just do good works and you'll get to heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say, just know about God and you'll get to heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that if you can volunteer or help out at a church or be born in America, it doesn't say any of that. There's only one way you're going to get to heaven. And Jesus said it in John, the third chapter. He said, you must be born again. In other words, you can't think enough, know enough. You can't be good enough. You can't volunteer enough to make it. It's out of your hands. You do not have the power to save yourselves. It has to be in God's power and in his strength. And Jesus said, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term, but let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. And if you haven't yet done that, like I hadn't yet done that at age 15, then I love you enough to tell you the truth, you're not going to make it. Now, you don't have to stay there. Tonight, I've got good news for you. I'm going to give you an opportunity, just like I did, to pray and to invite Jesus into your heart, and you can be born again right here, right now in this place tonight. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and then I'll pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang. All you got to do is just raise your hand if you know you need to do this. You're saying, I'm in that wilderness moment right now. I know I can feel the Spirit of God leading me towards this right now. There's that tug at my heart. I know I need to do this. Yes, I've been raised in church. Yes, I've been good. Maybe you've been a rascal. Maybe tonight you came searching. This is for you too tonight. Take this opportunity to get right with God before you leave this place by simply raising your hand. You say, but Pastor, wait a second. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. But think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. Come on. Tonight, this is family. Tonight, there are people who love you. Tonight, there's people that are rooting for you. We're excited about you. We've all done this. Listen, I just told you how it happened to me. Now, tonight is your night. Can it happen to you? Absolutely. All you got to do is just push past that embarrassment. Know that you're among friends and family tonight and get ready to get your hand up. There's no judgment, no criticism, no condemnation, just encouragement and excitement on your behalf. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today's your day, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you didn't play in church, playing games, kind of in and out, up and down, you know, little token prayer every now and again, little church attendance. Listen, get off the fence. Jesus said in or out. He said either hot or cold, because if you're lukewarm playing games, he says, I will vomit you from my mouth. Book of Revelation. Tonight, will you give him all of your heart? All, go all out for Jesus. That's you in any of those four categories I just described. Get ready to get your hand up. Whatever you're at, I see you guys in the family room. If you're watching by television in the foyer or down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, get your hand up, and then you can tell an usher or come into the church service right afterwards. Online, if you're watching live stream, wherever you're at around the world, come on, God sees and God's watching. He can see your hand go up, and he'll acknowledge you right where you're at. And then afterwards, you can minimize your video browser, click the blue button that says Respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and find the tab on the right-hand side that says How to Know God. Someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me if that's you right now. Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Thank you. There's one. God bless you. There's two. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. On this side, there's three. Got you over there. Thank you. Who else tonight? There's three wise people. You need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Anybody else real quick? Is that a hand back there? Thank you. Got you right there, number four. Who else tonight? Come on. Come on. You know you need to give God all your heart. You know you need to give God all of your life. You feel that leading, that tugging at your heart. If that's you right now, don't resist it. Just let God lead you tonight. Thank you. Got you over there, number five. Who else tonight? Come on. You've resisted God long enough. Tonight is a night where you say, okay, God, I'm laying down, surrendering God who I am to take up who you are. Anybody else real quick tonight? If that's you, we got five wise people already. You won't be alone, and I won't embarrass you just like I didn't embarrass them. Anybody else? All right. Well, let's give the Lord a praise for five wise people. Hallelujah. All right. All five of you, quickly, quickly, get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Why don't you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So if that's you, you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand. It's not too late. Come on, get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front right now. Come on down. Let's welcome them. Let's all stand. And if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down to the front. Come on, come on. That's you. They're coming. Let's give them a hand. They're still coming. Come on. All right, come on. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Anybody else, if you need to come, come on down. Come on down. All right. Hey, you guys. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. Came to give God all your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Right over here is my friend, Pastor Joel. Really good guy. He's going to lead you in that prayer we talked about to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again tonight. That's exciting. All right? Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. And then after that, he'll just describe to you a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, it's a friend in church, okay, that'll come alongside you, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. You know, I didn't grow until I had someone come alongside me, teach me some things out of the Bible to help me to find out what to do in my walk with God. Spiritual personal trainer is that friend who will do that for you, and then he'll let you come right back out, okay? Your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys will just make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel. Come on, let's give him a hand as they go. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Woo! God is good.